Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members that COVID-related measures are in place and that face coverings should be worn while moving around the Chamber and indeed the wider campus. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and this time portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. I remind members that questions 3 and 6 are grouped together, and I'll take any supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. And if a member wishes to ask a supplementary on any of the other questions, could they please press the request to speak buttons at the point of the relevant questions. We have quite a bit of interest this afternoon in some questions more than others. It won't surprise you to learn, so I would appreciate succinct questions and succinct answers from the ministerial team as well. And with that, I call question number one, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assistance it's giving to people in the creative industries who are self-employed and may have work cancelled due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. The Scottish Government recognises the substantial challenges that the COVID-19 pandemic has presented to self-employed people and freelancers in the creative industries. We've already provided £240 million to the culture sector over the pandemic, and that includes £65 million to help alleviate the financial pressures that both individuals and businesses have been facing following cultural venue closures and event cancellations in light of the Omicron variant. The support includes a £10 million cancellation fund for creative freelancers to support freelancers experiencing immediate financial hardship following cancellations. Self-employed individuals operating as a cultural organisation are eligible for the new £25 million COVID-19 cancellation fund for cultural organisations via Creative Scotland.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I would like to ask him how many freelancers have applied to the cancellation fund for creative freelancers since it opened in the first week of January, and to ask if the money that they can claim will extend to the hiring of equipment which they may have also had to cancel. And I know it will be an issue for many freelancers in television production and live music in particular.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member is absolutely right. As of yesterday, that was the 19th of January, there have been 1,728 applications to the Creative Scotland Freelancers Cancellation Fund, requesting a total of £2.94 million. 61% of the applications are from freelancers in the music sector. Creative Scotland has so far paid £1.05 million to freelancers. For the Freelancers Fund, applicants need to evidence cancellation and then they self-assess what the cost of cancellation is up to the £2,000 limit. And specific to the question, a creative freelancer can include hire of equipment in their application as long as the claim does not exceed £2,000.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary from Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary say what flexibility is in the guidance to support people to keep them in our creative industries now, especially those who've had to work incredibly hard to juggle behind the scenes and who've had to try and get work in other sectors but have basically not managed to keep going because of the lack of employment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can give Sarah Boyack the absolute assurance that the assessment of funding that has been undertaken by Creative Scotland, to whom I pay tribute incidentally because a lot of hard work has had to go into getting the schemes up and running during the festive season, dealing with closures in December, January and eventually through to March as well. But flexibility has been shown in the assessment of claims that are being made, especially to hone in on both individuals and businesses who are facing insolvency. And I want to give her and other colleagues across the Chamber the assurance that Creative Scotland and the assessment process is ensuring that there is an understanding of the existential challenge that people and businesses are facing. And I would appeal to colleagues, if they are aware of any cases where decisions are not being taken as expeditiously as they might perhaps in these kind of extreme circumstances, to please raise them with me, and I will ensure that Creative Scotland will look at that. I have no reason to believe that that is the case, but I want to ensure that people are aware that a great effort is being undertaken to undertake these steps as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Question number two, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what staffing resources it has allocated to the preparation work for a new independence referendum.
Cabinet Secretary.
Much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Work on the programme for government commitments to hold an independence referendum and developer prospectus for independence within this parliamentary term is being coordinated by the Constitution and Cabinet Directorate. Officials in teams across a range of portfolios will contribute to the work as part of their wider responsibilities to support the Scottish Government. I'm pleased that Maurice Golden acknowledges in his question that there will be a new independence referendum, and we intend that to be conducted during this parliamentary term.
Maurice Golden.
Children's education has suffered, the NHS is stretched to breaking point, and the economy is still fragile. Even the SNP must recognise recovering from the pandemic is the real priority for the people of Scotland. So does the Cabinet Secretary not see that another damaging, disruptive, divisive referendum will put the recovery at risk?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I gently say to Maurice Golden, because he was rehearsing the speeches that he was giving during the Scottish Parliament election campaign, clearly, is that this question has been settled. His party and my party went to the public to ask for their support in an election. His party lost that election. The Scottish National Party and the Scottish Green Party were elected on a mandate to conduct a referendum during this parliamentary term. Normally in democracies, opposition parties try and hold the government to account to deliver what they have promised to do in their manifesto. We were elected with a mandate to deliver a referendum. I look forward to Maurice Golden ensuring that we do just that, and I will be happy that we deliver on a manifesto promise that we were elected to deliver.
And we have a number of supplementaries here. I'll try to get through as many as I can. Firstly, Kenny Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise the Chamber how staffing resources allocated to preparing for a new independence referendum compared to the number of staff currently dealing with Brexit more than a year after we left the European Union?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've explained previously, staff from a number of parts of the Scottish Government will be involved in work to prepare for a referendum on independence. To put that in context, civil servants from business areas all over the Scottish Government continue to work on matters resulting from the UK Government's determination to pursue a hard Brexit against the democratic will of the people of Scotland, such as the estimated £9 billion cut to Scotland's GDP by 2030 and the damage to Scottish businesses wishing to trade with the EU facing all sorts of unnecessary new barriers. That work has, for example, required some 98 separate pieces of secondary legislation alone just to keep the statute law working.
Thank you. I'm Willie Rennie.
Just because the Tories have got it wrong doesn't mean the SNP have to get it wrong as well. I just can't believe my ears. I stood on a platform, I shared a platform with the First Minister throughout the election campaign, and I heard her say she would not push forward with an independence referendum and campaign until the pandemic was over. But we know fine well that the virus is still amongst us. But here we have a minister devoting scarce resources to an independence campaign. Just what on earth is he thinking?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would have thought for somebody espousing liberalism and democracy that they would recognise an election result. Governments need to do a great many things. And one of the things that we are going to be doing, because we were elected to do so in a democracy, is to conduct a referendum during this parliamentary term. And I'm sure Willie Rennie would be at the front of the queue if the preparation work wasn't being made in the run-up to that referendum.
Neil Gray.
I welcome this allocation of resource to honour the SNP's manifesto commitment to deliver a referendum in this term and also the Scottish Government's programme for government. I wonder whether those preparations might include looking into whether or not the Better Together promises that were made in 2014 have since been honoured.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can certainly raise that when we get to that stage of the preparations. I don't think it'll take a long time to research whether the promises and the threats that were raised by the Better Together campaign of the Liberal Democrats, the Labour Party and the Conservative Party who campaigned together have been broken or not, because most of them have.
And Colette Stevenson, as briefly as possible.
Can the Cabinet Secretary advise whether preparation work for an independence referendum will be looking at how the UK has fared economically and socially in the 21st century compared to its neighbours in Northwest Europe?
And as briefly as possible, please.
I can give my colleague an absolute assurance. The answer is yes, and with good reason.
Thank you. We now move on to question number three, and Katie Clark.
Ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the discussions it's had with the UK Government regarding people seeking resettlement in the UK who could be relocated to Scotland if they already have existing family connections, including in relation to correspondence with MSPs on this matter.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Katie Clark, who's persistent on this issue? I know she cares about this deeply. We engage regularly with the UK Government, with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, with individual local authorities and other partners to ensure that people are provided with the safety and security that they need to rebuild their lives in this country. The UK Government is responsible for refugee resettlement and relocation and the Home Office for the provision of accommodation. However, we continue to request that consideration is given to preferences, including where there are family and other connections wherever possible. Scotland is committed to playing our part in welcoming people fleeing Afghanistan. I'm delighted that all of Scotland's 32 local authorities have confirmed their participation in the scheme.
Katie Clark.
My experience, and I suspect that of others in the Chamber, is that the Home Office is not responding to correspondence from MSPs or MPs who are acting on behalf of individuals who are trying to get out of Afghanistan. An investigation by Open Democracy in December found that more than 99% of calls to the UK Government helpline were unanswered and only 5% had received the necessary assistance. Would the Cabinet Secretary be willing to use his role to take this issue up with the Home Office and ask that more resources are put into this work?
Cabinet Secretary.
The situation with the Home Office is hugely disappointing. I think people in the circumstance that they find themselves in deserve respect, and they deserve their situation to be dealt with expeditiously and with consideration and empathy. Can I encourage her and any other members of this chamber who have this experience, which is not a rare one, unfortunately, please feel free to forward on any constituent correspondence on this. I'll be happy to take that up with the Home Office, although I have to say to her that I'm not brimming with confidence that the Home Office will miraculously change the course of the way that they've been dealing with this, but I would be happy to raise any constituency cases that she or other MSPs across the chambers might have.
Thank you. And question number six, Mercedes Villalba, who joins us remotely.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its discussions with the UK Government regarding the resettlement scheme for Afghan refugees who may be resettled in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government met with Victoria Atkins, the UK Minister for Afghan Resettlement, on the 10th of January to discuss the launch of the UK's Afghanistan Citizens Resettlement Scheme. At this meeting, she raised the issue of property, offers made by local authorities waiting to be matched by Afghan families, and the need to do so as soon as possible. She reiterated that funding provided by the UK Government to support Afghan families in Scotland needs to accurately reflect the need in Scotland. It was also agreed that more regular four-nation engagement will take place to discuss Afghanistan resettlement across the UK, which I know the Cabinet Secretary looks forward to.
Mercedes Villalba.
I thank the Minister for his response. The UNHCR can only register Afghan citizens as refugees or asylum seekers once they're outside of Afghanistan and in another country. But there are still those in Afghanistan who remain at severe risk from the Taliban, especially if they're caught trying to travel to Iran or Pakistan to seek asylum through the UNHCR. So will the Scottish Government push the UK Government to clarify which safe routes will be available through the Afghan Citizens Resettlement Scheme, particularly for those who would be at risk travelling to another country to seek asylum?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that's an entirely reasonable suggestion, although I think we also need to bear in mind that some of the routes for people to take leaving Afghanistan have an understandable cloak of secrecy, so as the Taliban are then not able to pursue those who are seeking refuge in other countries. I will consider the questioner's request, and we are in regular touch with the Home Office. I think having greater clarity on this is definitely something that we would all welcome, whilst also accepting that there is necessary secrecy for some of the routes through which refugees are able to safely get out of Afghanistan in the current circumstances.
Question number four, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment has been made of the impact of COVID-19 restrictions over the festive period on theatres and other performance venues.
Minister Jenny Gilruth. I'm sorry, Minister, we don't appear to be able to hear you just at the moment. Maybe you want to start your response again and see if that's been resolved. No, I'm afraid it's still not working. If you bear with us just a minute. Minister, will maybe just go to the Cabinet Secretary and, in the meantime for the response, and we'll come back to you trying to resolve your microphone issues for the subsequent questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Good. The Omicron variant has come at a particularly challenging time for the sector, a time where recovery from previous waves of the pandemic was beginning and significant sales for Christmas shows were predicted. I've spoken to theatre groups and performance venues directly and received daily updates about the impact the COVID-19 restrictions are having on the sector. The Scottish Government has made available £31.5 million to support cultural businesses, organisations, venue and independent cinema support and grassroots venues. The impact assessments associated with the restrictions, including a business and regulatory impact assessment, will be published in the coming weeks.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for understudying for his minister at that short notice. I am grateful for that reply. Capital Theatres in Edinburgh lost dozens of performances across the festive period. The King's Theatre alone lost 36. This comes as it does after 2 years of missed Edinburgh Festival performance. Cabinet Secretary, these are paying months for Edinburgh's theatre industry. Please, can you tell us what more your government will do to support the theatre industry in its revival?
Cabinet Secretary.
Speaking both as the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, but as the MSP for Edinburgh Central and many of the cultural venues in the capital, can I say to the member for Edinburgh West, I am absolutely seized of this issue. There is a challenge, the scale of which we understand, the fact that the Scottish Government reached very speedy agreement to find £65 million just prior to Christmas to address the scale of the challenge, I think evidences the seriousness with which we take the challenge. What I would say, however, to absolutely everybody in the chamber is that I think we all have a role, just as we're beginning to hopefully take the early stages with early confidence as we emerge from this variant of COVID, that we can support our cultural venues, that we can go and attend shows and concerts and exhibitions and the like. So I think we need a twin-pronged approach. We need to support our venues that have suffered over recent weeks and months, but we need to make sure as we are able to return and support the cultural sector that we do so wholeheartedly. And I would appeal to him and everybody else in the chamber, please, to join us in doing so.
A very brief supplementary from Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, the City of Edinburgh was particularly hit hard when restrictions were imposed with no notice to the cultural sector, including our treasured theatres. Many were left in limbo without the financial support that was needed to keep the sector going. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure the Chamber and indeed the cultural sector that if restrictions were to be imposed, adequate notice is given to prepare the sector and financial resources ready to be dispersed to the cultural venues?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, I think this is a very, very important question. We have, throughout the circumstances, had the closest working relationship with the cultural sector. I have spent many a Teams call with people right across Scotland's culture and artistic community. At the earliest point that any notice can be given of any public health measures, they are shared with the sector, as they are with the wider business community. Now, I hope, as I'm sure he does, that there will be no necessity to return to any form of safeguards, restrictions impacting on the cultural community. And in the meantime, we will do everything that we can, that we can disperse the necessary funds to ensure that individuals, businesses, venues, and so on, remain solvent and are able to bounce back. And as I, in my appeal to a colleague from the Liberal Democrat benches, I do to him as well, to all colleagues in Edinburgh and throughout the rest of the country, please let's do everything that we can to give as much confidence to people returning and supporting the cultural sector and our venues, and that will give them the greatest chance of success.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for stepping in. Question number five, from Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Culture Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding culture-led regeneration of our town centres.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
I want to see culture play a crucial role in the regeneration of town centres as we look towards recovery from the pandemic. Mainstreaming culture across government portfolios is a central part of our current work. The Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution and External Affairs and Culture and I held ministerial bilaterals on this last week and only yesterday. Our discussion with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy specifically explored culture's role in regeneration and our commitment to ensuring no places or people are left behind. I also intend to discuss this with Tom Arthur, who has ministerial responsibility for town centres.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Austin. Can I thank the Minister for that answer? From Wigton Booktown to the Stove Network in Dumfries, which led to the development of the mid-steeple quarters. There are many good examples of culture-led regeneration across Dumfries and Galloway. But given the big crisis our town centres face, does the Minister share my view that we need to redouble our efforts by increasing the support we give to culture-led, community-driven regeneration, and not just have a town centre-first approach when it comes to issues like planning, but also when it comes to funding for new cultural facilities in our towns?
Minister.
I thank Colin Smith for his supplementary question. I would broadly agree with the sentiment of what he's outlined, and as he will know, we have a manifesto commitment to develop a National Towns of Culture scheme, and we started scoping what that scheme will look like, and I think there's a real ambition there to create a network across the whole of Scotland celebrating our towns and their unique stories, and I think that's particularly pertinent given that 2022 also marks Scotland's Year of Stories. The scheme itself is going to build on Scotland's strong track record of taking a place-based approach to our cultural programmes, such as our innovative culture collective scheme launched last year. And I know that in Mr Smith's region, the Stove Network do fantastic work in the community and are currently benefiting from the support of our culture collective funding. More broadly, though, with regard to funding, and I think how we link up better across different government departments, I hope Mr Smith has listened to my original answer in which I alluded to my meeting with Mr Arthur. And with regard to the regeneration of town centres, I would like to speak to Mr Arthur about this to ensure we get that greater policy coherence. But in terms of the funding in communities, the Cabinet Secretary and I are absolutely committed to driving a cultural recovery from the pandemic, which is rooted in our communities.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary from Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In Renfrewshire, spending in culture and heritage decreased by over a third between 2016 and 2019. Clackmannanshire saw a drop of 27% and Glasgow 18%. How will she then promote culture locally when some of her own councils are slashing their arts and heritages budgets by a third?
As briefly as possible, please, Minister.
I think Shandai raises a really important point, which is the role of local authorities in the delivery of culture locally. And one of the important ways we can do this whilst respecting the autonomy of local authorities is through the Culture Conveners Group, which I met with just before Christmas and which I will be meeting with in March. Hope that gives Shandai reassurance that I take this matter very seriously. And I think it's imperative that we look at the different approaches local authorities are using and we ensure equity of access across the country in terms of our cultural services.
Question number 7, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is supporting people working in the cultural and arts sector.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I appreciate that this is a difficult time for the cultural sector, even with the announcement, of course, of the easing of restrictions on Tuesday. The Scottish Government has previously provided £175 million of emergency funding to the culture, heritage and events sectors since the start of the pandemic. As a result of the recent restrictions, we announced an additional £65 million for the sector. This includes £31.5 million for cultural businesses, organisations, venues and independent cinemas and grassroots venues, £2 million for the national performing companies, £10 million for freelancers, £19.8 million for the event sector and £1.7 million for museums, galleries and heritage.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Following the First Minister's announcement in December requiring theatres to be restricted until next week, I have been contacted by constituents working for the Ambassador Theatre Group in Glasgow who work across the King's Theatre and the Theatre Royal. ATG took the decision not to call up any of their 0 hours contracts or casual workers during the period of closure. This has meant 150 of my constituents have lost out on at least 4 weeks' pay. Instead, to ease the financial burden, it was recommended by ATG that they use their holiday hours. Fully contracted staff, of course, have continued to receive full pay. These workers support
Question,
moves
please, Ms. Duncan
to stop the spread of the virus. But does the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister agree with me that workers should not shoulder the financial burden of these decisions? And can she guarantee that any emergency funding being offered to arts and events organisations is contingent on conditions they do not use zero-hour contracts and that all zero-hour staff are compensated for the loss of earnings?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would share Pam Duncan-Glancy's concerns about zero-hours workers not being supported for their losses as a result of theatre closures, and I'm aware of the situation in Glasgow. My officials have discussed the issue of zero-hours contractors in the cultural sector with Creative Scotland, who Ms Duncan-Glancy will appreciate administer the funds. And as she will know, the Freelancers Cancellation Fund does exclude 0 hours contract staff. However, the Cultural Organisations Cancellation Fund does not exclude organisations from applying for costs for their 0 hours contract staff. I would expect any organisation who applies to the Creative Scotland Cultural Organisations Cancellation Fund to use any money they receive to pay all staff that they employ. This should include any 0 hours contract staff. Hope that reassures Ms. Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, Minister. And a very brief supplementary to Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister provide any further detail as to what assessment has been made regarding the impact of the removal of furlough on people who are working in the culture sector?
And please, as briefly as possible, Minister.
Presiding Officer, Jenny Minto is absolutely correct to point to the importance of furlough to the creative sector throughout the pandemic. It provided a layer of financial support which we, as a devolved government, simply could not. Its removal has increased anxiety in the sector and has led to many creatives simply walking away. The First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister in December on this matter, and it was also raised in the Four Nations Culture Call on Tuesday of last week.
Thank you. And question number 8, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, when it last met representatives of the live music and nighttime industry sectors, and what was discussed?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, since the pandemic started, the Scottish Government has engaged regularly with the live music and nighttime industries to discuss issues such as guidance and business support. The Minister for Business, Ivan McKee, responsible for nighttime industries, last met with the Nighttime Industries Association on the 12th of January. I met with music industry representatives on the 22nd of December, along with the Cabinet Secretary, to discuss the impact of Omicron. And most recently, I met with Celtic Connections and Glasgow Life on the 18th of January.
Tess White.
Minister, the live music, nighttime economy and hospitality sectors in the North East continue to suffer as a result of the vaccine passport, with the Nighttime Industries Association highlighting losses of up to 30% in trade. When will the Scottish Government heed the calls of business owners and scrap this punitive scheme?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I apologise, but I cannot share the sentiment of the question from the member. I have to say that the number of cultural organisations the Cabinet Secretary and I have met with welcomed the vaccine passport scheme. They welcomed it because it allowed them to stay open and to stay open safely. It is fundamentally crucial to us reopening safely and to allowing our cultural venues to open and to succeed in the coming years and months. And we very much hope that the challenges the sector face this Christmas will be behind them. But the vaccine passport system has not been rejected by those in the cultural sector. So I cannot agree with the sentiment of the member's question.
And due to the technical difficulties, I will overrun this a little further to allow a supplementary from Stephanie Callaghan, but as briefly as possible, Ms Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, we've heard already that event cancellations are having a substantial effect on the live music sector. Does the Minister believe that the reinsurance schemes currently provided by the UK Government go far enough to protect the sector?
Again, as briefly as possible, please, Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has called for the UK Government to take action to address the market failure for events insurance since the pandemic began. The UK Government responded to those calls on the 5th of August last year with the announcement of an £800 million scheme, which does extend to Scotland. But it is regrettable the UK Government chose not to engage with Scottish ministers on the scheme's development. I know that many stakeholders have also indicated the scheme is not working in practice. What that means is that event organisers cannot afford the cost of the UK Government scheme, which they argue is financially prohibitive. I would reiterate our call on the UK Government to work with the sector to identify improvements to the scheme. And I raised this matter most recently during the Four Nations Culture Minister's call.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause while the front benches change for the next item of business.